So hi, everyone, and thank you so much for being here, and more importantly, for your interest, for your curiosity into the malicious crypto mining space. And it is one of the fastest growing emerging threats in the entire threat landscape today. If you are interested in the space, you have probably seen all these headlines talking about 2018 being the year of malicious crypto mining. You have probably seen other headlines talking about how ransomware is out and crypto mining is in. But you might also be looking into the market and how the market cap for the cryptocurrencies, most cryptocurrencies are going down significantly. And you might be asking, you might be thinking to yourself, maybe the growth in malicious activities is proportional to the activity or the growth in the currencies, which might totally be the case. But as researchers in the field, what we see is the opposite. The truth is that the crypto mining activity has never been like higher. It is massive. It is geometrically increasing. To give you an idea, it increased about 20x in the year of 2018, and in the last 2 months of 2019, in the first 2 months of 2019, it has grown another 10x. So we're going to go into the details of all of that in a second here, but allow me to quickly go over the agenda with you. We will start with a round of introductions. So Austin and I will be talking about our childhood memories in detail in a second. And right after we're done, we'll be talking about the birth of cryptocurrency, the state of the market, how the lack of regulation is affecting everything, why hackers are interested into the space. We'll be talking about cryptojacking, crypto phishing, how there is this attack surface that's happening, especially in the currency exchanges. And we want you to leave the session with the fundamentals, but we want you to have a technical understanding of what's going on in each and every one of these pieces. So we will be going into a lot of detail, especially towards the end, in those sessions where we are talking about phishing and altcoins and exchanges. And obviously, we would like you to leave the session with some action items and how we think that you should be protecting yourselves against this threat landscape. But before that, I'll pass the ball to Austin to talk about his childhood memories first.
You mind if I?
Okay.
All right, so first, I got a haircut, just a little bit different. So I'm a threat researcher at Cisco Umbrella. I have a BS in data mining and economics. I'm a crypto enthusiast. I do a lot of cryptographic trading and things like that, as well as my hobbies are obviously trading and lots of work. Now I'm going to switch it back over to Ayse, and she'll introduce herself.
So to highlighting the fact that Austin is a trader, a miner, and a threat researcher
yes.
at the same time, and it's all good, I guess. So about myself, my name is Ayse. I'm part of Cisco Umbrella, Cisco Cloud Security Organization. I'm part of the Insights and Analytics team there. My background is in applied math and engineering and operations research. I really loved fooling around with technology as a kid. I really loved breaking things apart. Not wasn't very glamorous. That was a lot of trouble for my parents. We weren't talking about our childhood memories, right? Sorry about that. So fast forwarding. So after I graduated from my second master's degree, I started working for startups and management consulting companies. And what I have done for them was basically looking into analytics and basically driving insights from complex, large, big data sources and making it available to our business and our customers. And that's exactly what we do with our team in Cisco Cloud Security. What we do is we are blessed with, we are very fortunate to work with a huge amount of data being Cisco scale and size, right? We see 175 billion queries a day. That's, like, to put things into perspective, that's 1/3 of the internet at large. And it's also, like, you know, it's again, just to set the stage, this is orders of magnitude higher than the number of Google searches that happens in a day. And it is not just the volume of the data, the diversity of it. So we see queries coming from across the world, 160 different countries, 90 million users out there. And it is like, again, the richness, the diversity of it allows us to really talk about statistically significant results in the data. So what we do is we take all of this data, organize it, curate it, and we start seeing outliers as well as trends in the data. When I talk about, like, outliers, we can actually see a customer all of a sudden seeing significant amount of crypto mining, malicious crypto mining traffic. And we can also look into industries and see in time which industries are being targeted the most, what sizes of businesses or geographies, and if things are changing along the way, we can actually report that too. And we basically use a lot of visualizations to make the findings crystal clear and so that our audience understands the results with clarity, okay? So with that, let's start talking about cryptocurrency a little bit. So you might call them electronic cash. I have heard it being called virtual commodity. And others, but it all goes back to October 2008, when there was this paper that came out, and even before that, the first Bitcoin was designed. And 2008 was a specific year where, you know, you might remember there was a financial crisis going on. A lot of people were questioning the validity, the shortcomings of financial institutions and traditional currencies. And this paper, the short paper, came out, and this, you know, so-called mysterious Satoshi Nakamoto, she wrote this paper titled Bitcoin, Peer-to-Peer Electronic Cash System. And the important key phrase in that headline is peer-to-peer. Is talking about a decentralized system. And basically, in the first sentence, she does, I like to call her she, because we don't know who that person is still. She's talking about an online payment system where one party can make a payment to the other without the need for a financial system. So fast forwarding to today, right? It was that the market was obviously nothing at that time. Fast forwarding to today, although the market has seen significant decline after its January 2018 peak, it is still a huge market. Yesterday we were looking at the overall market size with Austin. I think it is still above 130 billion. Yep. Although at its peak it has seen 835 billion. So after those 10 years, right, you might start thinking about cryptocurrencies as being more becoming more mainstream, but since it is, the system is still very under-regulated, and it is highly volatile, and the space is full of malicious actors, it is still wild, wild west, unfortunately. And speaking about regulations here, right? So the regulatory space here is there's no global consensus, basically. When you, like, there are certain countries that even question the legality of cryptocurrencies. There are others that allow their financial institutions to operate in these markets. But big geographies, like, you know, big countries like China, for example, ban their financial institutions to take part in these markets. So think about the tax consequences, or the insurance aspects of this, or even, like, you know, money laundering, things like that. The rules that have to be put into these systems, it is far from being a reality yet. Okay, and basically with all of that, the existing crypto exchanges the security measures that they have are not even close to the maturity that we see in the traditional equity markets out there. And that's why hackers probably have found the perfect crime with this, because they can actually go undetected forever in this space. And we will be talking about the mining piece of it in a moment, but it is fairly easy, not trivial, but it is easy to mine cryptocurrencies, and because of the profitability in the space, especially if you're using someone else's resources, the hackers are drawn to the space and they're highly active in the space, although the market is going down. So let's start talking about cryptojacking and crypto mining first, but you know, the basics of crypto mining. So when you think about crypto mining, it's very similar to, it is not very, very different from the existing transactions, the way you think of it, right? So when you actually make a transaction using your own bank account, your bank, basically being the central authority, records this transaction, and they maintain your balances so that in the long term they can actually refer to this transaction in the past. With the cryptocurrencies, they accomplish the same function by basically recording everything in a database. In the Bitcoin case, it is a Bitcoin database. And unlike the banking system, what you can do is anybody here can donate their computing power so that these transactions are actually, in your system, as you run a software, these transactions are actually recorded in the Bitcoin database. Okay, so I think that's so far we have spoken about a system that's like that is pretty decentralized and can work perfectly. The cryptojacking piece comes into the place when you think about crypto mining, not necessarily malicious or illegal by any means, but to really make money out of crypto mining, you need to do massive scale software transactions, right? And to be able to do that, you need to have a lot of computers working for you doing this, and that's why hijackers are coming into the place and start using unmonitored computing resources to mine currencies. So they basically, in the cryptojacking's case, it is, they start using businesses' computer power to mine currencies through individual machines, browser exploits, or cloud AWS instances and what have you. Okay. So we were talking about how the traffic is going up. This is something that we have been tracking since March 2018. And as I mentioned, the last 10 months of 2018, we have seen a 19x increase in crypto mining traffic. And this is traffic that goes to crypto mining tools, but we also see some sites that drop mining software onto your machine. So it is a combination of both. But in January, we started seeing another spike, another 10x increase in the last 2 months. And since we look into not just corporate traffic, but also the individual's traffic, right? The consumer's traffic, we can actually compare if businesses are targeted more than consumers. In the last 10 months of 2018, we have seen that the consumers were not being as targeted. Businesses were under fire, but the consumers were not being targeted as much. But with the recent peak, the 10x increase in the last 2 months, we are seeing that the individuals are being targeted more and more. Okay. And when you look into the traffic, it is not homogeneously distributed, and it is very dynamic. As I just mentioned, a 10x increase, a 20x increase, an overall 200 times increase from the very beginning, right? We see things trending in different ways as you look at different time frames, but overall we have seen higher education, energy and utilities, local governments, healthcare and media being targeted a lot more than other vectors that we have been looking into. With higher education, the major cost for crypto mining is basically having an internet being able to get electricity, hardware, and most of those are free for students, so we can understand that to a certain extent, but it could be actually external factors. We cannot really, we can actually see if it is done by one origin ID, meaning that maybe an IT admin going rogue and using an isolated server out there, or if it is not condensed. Basically, it is really distributed in a system. And in most cases, in higher education, we see that these attacks are pretty distributed. It is not a single person, but it's probably a website with a JavaScript exploit that's going on. With energy and utilities, these are all hypotheses, by the way. It could be the fact that they have outdated infrastructure. It could be systems that that needs to be updated, things like that. But these things, again, they fluctuate every few months. So we have seen, for example, higher education being on top for quite some time, and right now we are seeing energy and utilities being on top. Okay. And same applies to geo distribution. The usual suspects, the US, the North America, seeing a lot of crypto mining traffic, but for a couple weeks we have seen a Swedish MSP causing a lot of the traffic. It's actually, going back to the industry's case, there was one K-12 institution that accounted for more than 50% of crypto mining traffic in the earlier days when we started tracking this. So these things happen too, so, and it changes the entire entire system, entire donut chart as we look at these things in time. But we're seeing weird, unexpected, I should say, geographies as well, South Africa has been top out there. We have seen Peru out there for a couple days. And again, things fluctuate. But we know that US countries, US in general, has been hit largely the hardest by crypto mining so far. And we can actually look into different sizes of businesses as well. So we, and it is not just like we can look into crypto mining traffic, but we can compare it to malware traffic and phishing traffic. In the case of phishing for the year 2018, when we looked into how it is distributed between different sizes of business, we have seen that majority of the phishing traffic was coming from very large enterprises that had more than 10,000 employees. In the case of crypto mining, we are seeing that medium-sized businesses that has between 1,000 and 10,000 employees are being targeted a lot, but again, those things can change over time. And you might be thinking right now, I have seen a lot of security researchers thinking about crypto mining as being relatively benign. Basically, the hackers are not really taking down systems, taking away data, stealing identities, what have you. But they're just on the background, they are stealing away your electricity resources, etc. But the thing is, when you look into traffic, we see that about in 2018, we've seen about 50% of all traffic was software-based miners. So basically, the hijackers, the attackers, found a way to penetrate into your system. They installed a miner in your system, and right now, maybe they're using just 10%, 20% of your resources. They're very careful. They see this as a recurring revenue model where they go under the radar for a long time, so they don't really hijack the systems and use it at full scale. But they are in there doing something, and if they want to, they can actually do something else too. They can exfiltrate data, they can hold your data ransom. So it's like it's a system. It shows that these systems are already penetrated. So just don't think about web-based miners where you see a spike in traffic into certain crypto miners, but think about the software-based miners, which is probably one of the most important points of this entire talk. But with that, I'll transition over to Austin to go into the details of these different miners.
Sure. All right. So with web-based mining, basically we're looking generally at JavaScript exploits or advertisements that are being served on websites that happen to be doing a little bit of mining while you're visiting the site. As you can see with the spike here, as soon as you leave the page, it's done. It's no longer using your computer's resources. In the case of software miners, we're talking about something that's running in the background on your machine, whether it's a server, individual laptop, a phone. And it's doing that as long as it's connected to the internet. So you do have a higher risk of damaging hardware and the software case. And as Ayse mentioned, it's actually really risky because depending on whether it was an employee who installed it, who was just trying to make a little extra money on the side, or someone who's a malicious actor, if a malicious actor's in there, then they could do something else once mining is no longer profitable for them or they want to switch to something else. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about mining difficulty. So I'm sure we've all seen how the market's kind of taken a bit of a dive recently. It'll come back eventually. But you would think that mining traffic would go down when the market goes down, when it costs more to generate a unit of the currency than it does for the costs of electricity and internet connection and things like that. But that's actually not what we're seeing. We're seeing quite a bit of an increase in traffic because they are not paying for the cost. They're using your electricity, your internet connection, as well as your hardware to run this. So it behooves them to keep doing it as long as they can and going unnoticed, keeping the threshold low and moving that way. So now I want to talk a little bit about mining costs. So I'm going to use an example, CoinHive in this case. I know CoinHive is shutting down here pretty soon. But basically, the only cost that is associated with the malicious actor mining in your environment is one, them getting in there in the first place, and then two, the fee that they pay for whatever third-party software they're using, like CoinHive or another service, in order to mine that currency. So it's very cheap for them to get in, no more expensive than they would if they were setting up a phishing site. So you know, CoinHive is, here's an example, and as I said, CoinHive is going away, but the majority of the traffic that we're seeing is actually not CoinHive, or as far as the web miners are concerned, CoinHive traffic. It's other types of pools and other scripts that can easily be gotten on GitHub. So we see a lot of different devices targeted when it comes to either software or web-based mining. Smartphones, not so much anymore, but PCs, EC2s are wildly popular because there's a lot of computing power there, and you can mine quite a bit of currency. Then websites, Java, script exploits, and servers. So I'm sure we've seen the news. So there are a lot of different ways you can kind of mine or you can steal resources. And Tesla's case, we had an AWS instance compromised, and that was because the Kubernetes password was not like up to snuff. So that can happen. We've seen third-party apps like, you know, Lyft and other normal apps with embedded miners. And then we can see websites also being basically inserted with JavaScript exploits. And with the websites, typically what they're going for domains where a person is actually on the site for a long period of time. So you're reading news, you're watching a video. They want to use resources as long as possible, so they're going to target these sites in the first place. So here's a quick example of how easy it is. It's just a couple lines of code to get in, and they're going to set the threshold really low so that you kind of don't notice. And it might not directly have an impact on your enterprise business, but whoever your customers are that are consuming content on your site, they are definitely being impacted. And if the exploit is on your site, then you have another problem because someone got in and put it there in the first place. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about crypto phishing. So with many different phishing vectors, you'll notice some things that are quite consistent across the board. Email is still used. Search engines is actually being heavily used, as well as communication channels like Slack, Twitter, Telegram, and Discord. Mostly Telegram and Discord. They're a little bit more in with the crypto crew. But I'm going to actually focus on search engine ads because this is quite fascinating. So here we have an example of My Monero. And these are actually two malicious advertisements that are being served on Google. You can see that there's a little dot under the Y, so that's not quite right. And you can see the little mark above the O on the second one. And they're basically using PuniCode to do this. So they're wanting the actual domain as it appears and renders inside of your browser to look as close as possible to the actual legitimate site. And so here's an example for when the site was live. Of what it looks like. Login information, all of the site is completely the same as the legitimate site, but it is in fact malicious, and here's the second one. So you might think, well, you know, those were HTTPS, so inherently it's a little bit safer, but that's actually really not the case, especially with cloud service providers that offer wildcard certs. So it's very easy to have a secure SSL domain and it actually not be very secure at all. And so here's an example of a malicious ad that is in DuckDuckGo, another popular search engine. So I'm going to walk you through quickly how I created an advertisement for an exchange that obviously I have no, or a wallet that I have no affiliation with whatsoever. So it's very easy for them to use Google AdWords to set up an ad in order to phish and get your credentials to either get into your wallet or to get into your trading account and do whatever they want to do with it. This exact same method can be used for anything, really, getting into your Google AdWords account, getting into the back end of your website, et cetera. So it's quite heavily used. So if I was a malicious person, there's a couple different ways I could go about getting in. Probably the first and best for me would be to infiltrate your Google AdWords account in the first place. So I would use phishing to get that. I would get in and then I would create an ad using your money in order to send people who are visiting your site, who are clicking on the ad, to my own site that I can use to phish and get credentials from. So in this case, I would have to create basically a subdirectory on the site, not something that anyone can really super see unless they're looking for it, that'll redirect to the actual malicious site. And just to be fair, with Google, the domain that's being displayed in the ad, it can have a longer domain. It can have a tail with subdirectory attached, but it cannot actually lead to a different site. The redirect does not happen in the AdWord ad itself. It happens on the lander page. So what I would do is I would get in, I would create a subdirectory, and then I would set up a redirect to the fake site to get the credentials. So I did, I'm wallet, I'm going to phish you, just for fun. And then here's an example of the actual puny code that is associated with the real domain as it's registered, and then how, of course, it appears in the browser. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about exchanges and altcoins. These are a little bit more sophisticated tactics that some criminal organizations and individuals are using. So as I talked about before, they use ads to get in. They also use Twitter and other platforms and appear to be legitimate exchanges, saying, hey, listen, send me a little bit of money, a little bit of Ether. I'll send you, 10x back. It's promotion that's being run. You're so lucky, first 100 people who send me a message. And of course, it doesn't fool most people, but it fools enough for them to make a little bit of money, and they're happy with that. So I'm going to use a Binance example. Quick question, who knows what Binance is? Raise your hand. All right, excellent. Who uses Binance? Anybody? All right, one. All right, cool. All right, so Binance is a very popular cryptocurrency trading exchange. It's probably, it fluctuates between first and second as far as the number of dollars associated with cryptocurrency that's traded on a daily basis. And so this is a really good phishing website. So what they did was they did a complete copy of the front page, all of the prices update the exact same, all the promotions, documentation, all of that listed, it's 100% identical. And what they do, if you basically click on one or two links that would eventually lead you into a login page, you stay on the phishing site. If you want to go look at documentation or if you want to go look at a promotion that would not quickly lead to a login, they'll just actually forward you to the legitimate site. So they don't actually have to maintain all of the original legitimate site as they're trying to do these phishes. So let's say Austin, hey, that's fine, they can try to get it, but with CAPTCHA and two-factor authentication, I'll be safe, right? The login looks the same, the exact type of, CAPTCHA. And then what they can do is a two-factor authentication bypass. This is really easy. This is just a basic man-in-the-middle attack. So they'll get your credentials, you'll put in the website, the fake website, the phishing website, they'll send it to a legitimate exchange, be prompted for 2FA, then they'll serve that up to you on the phishing site, you put it in, and then they send that to the legitimate site. They log in as you, and then they just forward you to the legitimate site, and you just think, oh, I logged in, but somehow I didn't get in, let me try to log in again. At that point, they're in, and they can go set up trading APIs, or they can go ahead and try to withdraw your funds very quickly. So looking a little bit deeper, using Cisco Umbrella's Investigate, which is a tool that we have, I'm going to look a little bit into the whois record. So what is this bivnance.com, right? So we can see here that it's registered to a black 13 at unseen.is. That's not an email registration name that you generally think would be used for a big exchange like Binance. We can also see that it's under the registrar of Center of Ukrainian Domain Names. That's also a little suspicious. And then there's an IP range here, which is not an IP that Binance actually uses for hosting any of their site or content. So a bit suspicious. So if we pivot in and we look at all of the domains that have ever been registered by Black13 at unseen.is, we can see he's not only going for Binance, but he's also going for my Ether wallet. So he wants to get all of your ERC20 tokens. He didn't just want to get into your trading account. He wants to get in and steal all the funds that you think are in a relative safe wallet, right, online wallet. And you can see here are a bunch of different domains that are either live or staging. So they're about to go live, and every 3 or 4 days they will rotate that phishing site to the new domain in order to try to be as evasive as possible. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about altcoins as a vector. So this is, criminal organizations are really, really very fond of this tactic. So what they'll do is they'll use all those all the tactics we talked about before, phishing it into your account, but all they'll do is set up an API key for trading. And they'll do this for about 100, 200 accounts. They won't do anything besides set the API key. Most people are not trading via the APIs, and so you won't even notice that it's actually turned on in your environment for your account. And then what they'll do is they'll set up bots that will buy a certain coin. In this case, it was Vicoin. And they chose this coin because it's very low liquidity. It's only about, at the time, there was like 11 and a half Bitcoin in total liquidity for that given coin. So it's very easy for them to buy the entire purchase book. So all fill all orders, you know, buy, sells, everything they can do. And in doing that, they can jump up, they can jack up the price. And so that's what they did. They turned on their bots. They simultaneously had all of these accounts purchase cryptocurrency, whatever it was being listed at, pumped up the price about 10,000%. And then they were going to take their own Viacoin holdings, sell it at the top, and walk away with a good chunk of change. In this case, it backfired, and exchanges like Binance do have some security measures in place that if a coin 10,000x's in a matter of a couple of minutes, that's probably unusual. Let's go ahead and freeze withdrawals and deposits. But if that had not been the case, they actually would have walked away with a cool $32 million. So it's pretty lucrative. And these measures were not set up on some other exchanges, and they were able to get some of the funds, but just not quite the whole bucket. They did it primarily on Binance. So these are very sophisticated vectors of market manipulation. As Ayse was saying before about regulation, there's no FINRA or FDIC or anything like that. If you lose something or if you get hacked with crypto, you've pretty much lost it. So now I'm going to go and talk a little bit about how you can protect yourself. So for cryptojacking, DNS level domain blocking is actually really, really effective. And so when it comes to cloud computing resources, you want to look for, as Ayse was saying before, just a little bit of increase, right? They're not going to leverage your full AWS cloud instance and spin up a bunch of EC2s and mine as much as they can until they get caught. They're going to do it just a little bit, and they're going to do it for a long period of time, and they can rack up quite a bit of money. And they don't really care what the market price is at the moment. They just want to go unnoticed because they feel that the market will eventually recover, and most markets are, they go in cycles, and so they're just biding their time and waiting. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about one of our models that we use at Cisco Umbrella, and this is the co-occurrence model. So this is kind of guilt by association, or potential guilt by association. So we can take a domain like bivnance.com, the phishing site that I showed you before, and then look at the other records, that the other types of behavior that clients are doing, and what pages they're going to when they're browsing the internet. And so with that, we can say, okay, this certain chain of actions, 80% of the people who are going to these domains do. So if this other domain has the same type of traffic, then it might be associated, it might be similar. And then we go and look at the whois information and see who's registered it, and we can make further associations that way. And so in the case of CoinHive, rest in peace, CoinHive, we see some malicious domains that are just associated with phishing and browser redirects. A little bit lower, we see domains that have been cryptojacked, so they have CoinHive scripts, JavaScripts installed on the website, and they're mining it. So we've got a TV website, so watching movies. We've got another TV viewing site, Voodoo, and then web mining. The web mining one's actually pretty interesting. So they set up a fake CoinHive site, and they say, hey, install this, and you're going to make money, but then they just send the funds to their own wallet, and you make nothing. So that's kind of an interesting one. And they also have another mining strip, so they'll buy domains that are similar and try to set up similar types of things. So now looking specifically about how we approach classifying these types of domains and how we block it, we take the newly seen domain. So as Ayse was saying, we process about 180 billion DNS queries a day. and domains we've never seen before that are not in our database. We pull those and put them into a bucket, and then we start looking into them a little bit further. We say, hey, let's do a FQDN. Let's see, where is it hosted? Is it on an IP that we know is safe? Is it in a spot on the internet that we know is legitimate, or where the other legitimate sites are hosted? So that's the first thing. We'll fetch the HTML source code. We'll do a little bit of content classifications to do some comparing with the malicious site or potentially malicious site. And then we'll look at the infrastructure, okay, where is it hosted, right? And then we'll decide, okay, are we gonna block it, et cetera. So looking at this a little bit further broken down, we'll take in the data, and then we'll check to see if it is whitelisted, it's in a good spot, if it's in a safe place. Then we'll create a TF-IDF, and we'll count the words on the page. We'll create basically a hash, a signature for what's on that site, and then we will use that and use latent semantic analysis to basically compare the cosines of the site that we know is legitimate and the one that we've just seen, and we've never seen it before, but it looks similar. So we're comparing this to see, okay, is this a new page that the site just decided to spin up, or is it in fact a malicious person that's setting up a phishing site? And then once you have that classification and that score, the cosine score, of similarity, then you can decide to block it or send out an email, and then you use that to retrain the model as it goes on. So here's a little bit tidier version of it, where we'll get the vector of the actual legitimate site, and then we will create a corpus. And these are just a few of the exchanges that I'm listing, but we do this for all of them. And then we'll take the new domain query that we've never seen before to a site we've not seen, and then we'll create a vector of that. And we'll compare it to see if it is the same and if it has a login page and stuff like that, just see if something is quite, in fact, malicious. So here's the model at work. So lcoinbase.com, obviously the domain name is very similar, but also the source HTML code on the page is also very similar. It's got a score of 99.4%. Looking it up and investigate, we can see that it's registered to a Hotmail account. Again, probably Coinbase does not use Hotmail as their domain registration email. And then we can do a little bit further and decide whether we want to block it or not. So here's an example of the site when it was live. And this is, so I talked about phishing, I talked about cryptojacking, and they also use other vectors. They're not just focusing on crypto mining or on phishing and getting your wallet credentials. They are also doing ransomware. They're going to do every vector that they can that's related to cryptocurrency, because it's generally anonymous if you're doing things like Monero. And so it's a bit safer for them to operate. So they'll do ransomware, they'll lock up your machine, they'll tell you where to go buy Bitcoin, they'll sell you the Bitcoin at an inflated price. And so it's kind of like a double whammy for infected people. So it's very, very organized, and they're using multiple vectors. They're not just focusing on one thing. So in one case that we were tracking, this is the coin hoarder case, for those of you who are familiar. This is just one of the wallets that they were using, but in the period of about 3 months, just this one wallet did about $2 million. In stolen funds. So it is quite lucrative. But then you get to a spot where you basically are sitting on all this crypto, and it's very hard for you to buy those Lambos and villas and all those things that you really want to buy. So what can you do with it? Well, they can use it to buy additional infrastructure from cloud service providers that accept cryptocurrency as payment, and then kind of expand their impact, malicious impact on the world. So here are a couple of other examples of, of course, ransomware. They will also lock up databases. So let's lock it up, demand cryptocurrency for it. So it's not just websites, it's databases, it's everything. It's all across the board. So for ransomware specifically, this is kind of a quick chain of events. You'll get infected, encrypted, then you need to respond to the incident, restore from backup if you have it. If you don't, then you make the decision, am I gonna pay, am I not gonna pay? Okay, I'm gonna pay. And if I am gonna pay, I'm gonna have to buy cryptocurrency. I'm going to pay off. Hopefully, my stuff gets unlocked, and then I'm going to keep that currency handy in case this ever happens again. And generally, what we see is the malicious actor will go ahead and steal that too, since they were already in the first place. So now I'm going to turn it back over to Ayse, and she's going to summarize all the things that we talked about today.
Yep. Thank you, Austin. So I think the key insight here is that we have reached a critical turning point. You have seen the increases in the volume, and it is not just the sheer volume that we are talking about, although it is geometric, almost exponential. It is the software-based miners that are probably very critical. And it is, like, we looked into geographic distribution, the industry distribution, and it was obvious that no industry, geography, or size of business is immune to all these things. And basically, you know, we need to be looking into web-based miners as well as software-based miners, and looking into these software-based miners specifically is critical, because it means that a lot of these systems that we're looking at are already compromised. And to give you an idea, in the first half of 2018, when we start tracking the systems, these, you know, multiple consumer or customer environments, we were seeing that one in three customers were seeing crypto mining traffic. And right now it is, I believe it's one in two. So it's huge. We cannot just, you know, say, hey, this is benign, it is not that important, they're not really actually stealing away data, which they might be doing on the side. By the way, we just talked about how sophisticated it can get. So basically, what we want you to be thinking about is looking into this right away, immediately. Like, right next week, as you go back, start working, look through your DNS query logs and look for substantive amount of crypto mining tool traffic, pool traffic from one or several machines in the environments that you have. And in terms of the cloud computing instances, it could be as low as, you know, a couple percentage points, right? Think about a network, right? A hacker having 10,000 machines earning 30 cents per machine per day, right? It can add up to a lot of money, a recurring revenue model that I just mentioned about. It can be big for them, it can be little for your environment. And in the first 3 months of this presentation, if you actually see these types of traffic happening in your environment, block it right away. And especially if you're seeing consistent and considerable amount of traffic, which might be signaling software-based mining going on in your environment, you should definitely investigate that further. Now, it's a very highly, look, it is a very fast dynamic that we are seeing here. We are seeing new mining pool sites are being added into the system. So it is really becoming harder and harder, and the state of the solution to a problem like this actually requires three pieces, right? Large data, security analysts, and actual statistical machine learning models to look into that. So the solution that you have, you need, is probably going to be in the intersection of these three. So you might actually start thinking about vendors who are looking into the space closely, because it is not slowing down, however the market is behaving outside. So that's it. That's what we have. Would you like to add anything?
Yeah, I want to add a couple of different things. So you can go online and you can find legitimate websites that list a good chunk of pools that you can add to your, you know, DNS level block list. But that's only going to fix part of the problem. It's something that you definitely want to stay active on if you decide to block it, you know, on your own way. But basically, you really need a classifier type environment, something that a script that is running and is looking for the different types of traffic and different types of spikes, prolonged, that kind of stuff, to make sure that you are actually blocking most everything that you want that's in your environment. You know, web-based can and will appear in most environments, but sometimes it's very small, so it's just people who are visiting websites, and that's fine. But it could also be, if it's considerable, you know, web-based or web-based that has a JavaScript exploit, or software-based, which is even far worse. And so with that, questions.
Don't be shy.
Yes. So we've not seen any of that yet. I think, you know, we're in a rapid state of innovation when it comes to blockchain and to generating new coins and new ways of doing things. I definitely see that coming, but we've seen no indication of that yet.
Probably around the corner, though.
Yeah, I wouldn't think too long.
If I'm thinking of it, I'm sure they are.
Yeah, no, absolutely. They're thinking money. Yes.
Why they're stealing your resources to do crypto mining, is that
Yes. Yeah, so the most significant cost for mining is the hardware used for mining, and then the electricity, and then of course a good internet connection. When you can remove all of those costs, it behooves you to mine as much as you can on as many people environments, because the cost is then transferred to whoever is infected. And so that's why actually what we're seeing in universities, not that it's necessarily malicious, depends on the school's policy, but you get free internet and you get free power, and you can run a rig in your dorm for 4 years and walk out of college with a little bit of extra money to pay down that debt, right? Yeah. Yes, I mean that definitely is going to affect what's going on in the marketplace and where they choose to mine and what they're going to mine. Most of the mining farms aren't based in the U.S. All of what we're seeing mining-wise, mostly in the U.S., is using it maliciously. Most of it is people who are setting up the exploits on websites or infecting AWS instances and using the resources there. I think it's going to be a mix, but when it comes to organized criminal organizations, they probably won't do any sort of legitimate business, like buying power grid. They'll probably just stick onto the most anonymous thing, which is just getting in and installing it in your environment. Yeah,
because it costs zero when you actually use someone else's, right? As opposed to buying the power that you need for it.
Yep. So for home OpenDNS service, we are not allowing, or we do not have that as a configurable policy. And we do content blocking and some higher levels of blocking the really nasty stuff, like botnets and malware and things like that. But yeah, you would have to be an enterprise customer.
To be able to block crypto mining.
Speaking of which, if you already do use Umbrella as an enterprise customer, this is a policy that you can just go ahead and turn on. There's no additional cost if you're already using our service.
We didn't turn it on by default. We wanted our customers to self-select into that because they might think that some of the crypto mining traffic is benign. But as of now, I guess almost all of our customers are turning it on. So it's not a binary thing for them.
Yes.
If someone was mining for, let's say, Bitcoin, just with a general computer, just a standard desktop computer, like how many days or weeks or months does it typically take to generate one Bitcoin? And how do they know if they're successful technically generating that coin?
So it's kind of a race. So it depends on your rig, how fast you can compute, your internet connection. Generally, to just even recoup the costs of the internet, the electricity spent, and the rig that you bought, you're looking at least 9 months just to break even before you even get into making profit. And the difficulty is so high with Bitcoin right now that it just doesn't, you spend more in electricity than you're going to in generating the unit. But with the cryptojacking, they don't care because they're not paying any of the costs. And that's why we see the traffic just being exponential.
And how do they know, like technically, if they're successful in generating the coin?
So generally what they'll do is they'll take their miner and they'll attach it to a pool, and it'll be like a cloud resource where you, me, everyone else in this room, we all have rigs, we're all donating the resources, and then that pool will basically race to get the right hash and then get the unit of Bitcoin and then distribute that proportionately to however much computing power you donated to the cause. Good question.
And mining is becoming harder and harder because the system is designed as, you know, opposed to the traditional financial systems. There is an amount of bitcoins that could be generated. So right now, I guess 16 million of it has already been generated in the case of Bitcoin. And the upper limit is 21 million. And they say with the speed of generating bitcoins right now, the latest bitcoin will be generated in 2140. So it is becoming much, much harder to get that marginal bitcoin in the system.
And with crypto mining in general, they're going to switch to those alternative coins,
yeah,
those new and upcoming
15,000
ones.
Of them.
Yeah, that are easier to mine, don't take as long, and they can cash out a bit sooner. Right now, we don't see a whole lot of cryptojacking that is doing Bitcoin mining. Most of it's Monero and some other coins that are a little bit more anonymous, harder to track, so they can get away with it a bit easier. Yeah. What effect does it have on the market? That's the question. So we've not seen any like significant impact on prices related to this mining, just given like overall market prices. It's small. The market's a small market, but you would still need a vast amount of computing resources to really tip the scale price. You know, we do see manipulation in the sense of pump and dumps, so we see them doing that, but the resource requirements to actually influence it on a large scale like that would be pretty hard. It's possible, but we've not seen that yet. Any other questions? All right, well, with that, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you, everyone.